Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Jane on the Brain, Exploring the Science of Social Intelligence with Jane Austen, by Wendy Jones, read by Cassandra Campbell. Introduction. Empathic Austen. I blame my first marriage on Jane Austen. Elizabeth Bennet married for gratitude and esteem, and these were exactly the feelings I had for my first husband. If they were good enough for Elizabeth, why wouldn't they be good enough for me? But I wasn't Elizabeth. I was much more like Emma, a far more flawed heroine. The romantic Emma would never have been satisfied with gratitude and esteem, and neither was I. To be fair, I know my husband felt the same way, although I don't think he blamed Austen for his mistake. For better or worse, my hasty marriage was simple to undo, at least with respect to its legal and social aspects. For my next chapter, I returned to graduate school, pursuing a doctorate in English literature and specializing in Austen and other novelists of her time. Had I been a more daring scholar, I might have realized that my youthful folly had posed some interesting questions. Why did I look to Austen and her characters for guidance about how to live my own life? And I'm not by far the only one to do this. Surely this trust couldn't be separated from the great love I had for Austen. Why do so many people love Austen so intensely and in such a personal way? Austen certainly isn't the only literary celebrity among Anglo-American authors whose work inspires interest in her life. Captivated by the dark drama of Wuthering Heights, we visit Haworth, home of the famous Bronte family. Drawn into Elizabeth Dickinson's poetic vision, we tour the unassuming clapboard farmhouse where she slowly retreated to a life of solitude and poetry. Nor is Austen the only author who's created realistic characters. Nathaniel Hawthorne said that Anthony Trollope's novels were just as real as if some giant had hewn a great lump out of the earth and put it under a glass case, with all its inhabitants going about their daily business and not suspecting that they were made a show of. Indeed, readers tend to think of characters as real people when they read, especially when they read novels. One reason we read for the plot is that we want to find out what happens to people we've come to know and care about. Nevertheless, Austen exerts a power above and beyond that of most other authors. She has a fandom rather than a following, readers whose devotion goes well beyond literary appreciation to infuse many aspects of their lives. Janeites, the term for Austen devotees, are more like Trekkies than Bronte enthusiasts. Many are willing to dress in Regency fashion at the annual meeting of the Jane Austen Society as easily as a Trekkie dons the Federation uniform at a Star Trek convention. Many, like myself, find guidance about how to live their lives in Austen's work. But unlike Trekkies, who are more absorbed by the Star Trek world itself than by the writers who created it, Austen fans idolize the author as well as her works. Austen is our beloved wise cousin, our ally in the quest for the good life. Alas, the puzzle of Austen's influence didn't dictate the path of my scholarly research. In fact, musings of this kind were actively discouraged by the intellectual climate in many English departments of the time. At the elite institution I attended, thinking about characters as real people was strictly taboo, a sign of naivete and ignorance. Doctoral candidates were expected to be professional readers who realized that every text, we didn't call them books or novels, consisted of words on a page and nothing more. We were being trained to decode, not to read. Many of us still harbored a naive love of literature and authors, but this was our shameful secret, the mad woman who lived in hidden rooms in the attic. It would take another 20 years and a late flowering passion for psychology to prompt me to search for the reasons for Austen's allure. At this point, I was reading book after book on psychology and neuroscience, while also taking courses in the mind-brain sciences. I began to publish essays on the connections between literature, psychology, and the brain, and to teach on that subject as well. Thinking about Austen in the context of the mind and the brain, I was now able to find an answer to my question. So many of us love and trust Austen because she possessed extraordinary powers of empathy. Empathy means seeing the world from a different perspective, walking a mile or even a moment in someone else's shoes. It means actually experiencing, although in a weaker form, another person's state of mind, while also maintaining your own perspective. So if a friend is panicking, becoming anxious yourself wouldn't be true empathy, but rather emotional contagion. Empathy means understanding your friend's panic while at the same time realizing that the anxiety of the moment is hers, not yours. Such perspective taking involves thinking and feeling. Empathy's cognitive aspect requires theory of mind, TOM, also known as mentalizing or a reflective capacity, which refers to the ability to infer other people's beliefs and intentions from their behavior. This includes facial expression, body language, actions, and speech. If you see someone come into a room, look around, move papers and books, look under the desk, and then leave with a puzzled expression on his face, you're likely to think that he was looking for something that he didn't find. Theory of mind also includes the ability to recognize feelings, but in a dispassionate, knowledge-based sense. If you see your boss frowning, you realize that he's displeased about something and that this isn't the time to ask for a raise. You don't necessarily enter into his feelings. It's enough to know what they are. Many sociopaths can often read other people's feelings accurately, yet they possess zero empathy. Instead of empathizing with pain or sadness or even anger, they use their mentalizing powers to manipulate others. Empathy is much better known for its emotional qualities. The first of these involves emotional resonance, feeling what someone else is feeling in an intuitive, subliminal mode. Empathy further involves knowing that you're conscious of another's feelings, that these are not your own. In everyday usage, the word empathy is used to include sympathy, which means responding in an emotionally appropriate manner. For instance, with compassion for suffering and delight at happiness. A more technical definition of empathy refers to taking another's perspective and feeling what someone is feeling. True empathy includes both emotional resonance, the pure feeling part, and theory of mind, which includes your awareness that you're grasping someone's thoughts and emotions. Of course, when I say that Jane Austen had empathy, I'm inferring the mental powers of the living, breathing woman who's no longer with us from the evidence of the written record she left behind. But how else to explain Austen's array of differently minded and totally believable characters? For Austen to have created such a variety of convincing imaginary people, she must have been a profoundly astute mind reader of real people. And no one familiar with her work can doubt her compassion for the unfortunate or her glad participation in the happiness of others. She knew loss and thwarted love in her own life, which enabled her to portray the sufferings of disappointed love. But she could also show the joys of love's fulfillment. I can think of no other novel in which the happy ending is rendered so poignantly meaningful as it is in Persuasion. Yes. Austen must have possessed a high degree of empathy. Yet it's not an abstract appreciation of empathy that draws us to Austen, but the experience of empathy itself. Austen's uncanny ability to convey what others think and feel allows two kinds of empathy to take place for the reader. The first is the empathy we experience for her characters. Countless people have shared the feelings of these fictional people. Elizabeth's humiliation on reading Darcy's reproachful letter, which shows how greatly she's misinterpreted events, Pride and Prejudice. Marianne's pain on being rejected by Willoughby, the man she loves with all her heart, Sense and Sensibility. Emma's sudden realization that no one must marry Mr. Knightley but herself, Emma. The second experience of empathy is even more crucial. Because Austen understands human nature so thoroughly, we have the sense that she empathizes with us, her readers. To put this in the apt phrase of psychiatrist Daniel Siegel, when we read Austen, we have the feeling of feeling felt, of having our innermost feelings understood and resonated with. This is inherently gratifying because, as a species, humans crave such understanding. We have a profound need for empathy, to know that we're not alone with our joys and sorrows. These two kinds of empathy, of recognizing and feeling recognized, are two sides of the same coin. Austen conveys her understanding of us, her readers, precisely by creating characters that we identify with. And we are able to identify with Austen's characters because they mirror our ways of thinking and feeling. In fact, mirroring is an important way that empathy and other forms of resonance are communicated. In person, this happens through facial expressions and body language that imitate, and through speech that restates, one person's perception of another's state of mind. You're likely to convey empathy for a friend's distress by mirroring her facial expression, a furrowed brow, for instance, and telling her that you're sorry she's so upset. You reflect her feelings verbally, with the word upset, and non-verbally with a furrowed brow. In telling your friend that you're sorry she's feeling bad, you also express sympathy. But this is almost unnecessary because mirroring behaviors do more than simply reflect content. They convey caring. This is because humans automatically perceive mirroring as positive and, in the case of distress, comforting. And the brain knows how to tell the difference between mirroring and simply reacting. So vital is mirroring to conveying understanding and support that counselors who specialize in crisis management and suicide prevention are trained to restate the feelings of the person at risk as a major strategy for alleviating distress. This is known as reflective listening. And so, when we see ourselves reflected in Austen's work through characters who resemble us and others we know, it's like peering closely into a two-way mirror. We see Austen behind the glass, watching and understanding. She knows us, and we know that she knows us. We have the feeling of feeling felt. Other features, in addition to Austen's wide-ranging portrayals of fictional people, amplify our sense of empathy. Shared experience makes empathy more likely. If you've felt intense grief for the loss of a loved one, you'll empathize more easily and completely with someone whose grief is of a similar kind. It's also easier to feel empathy for people who are similar to us. The downside of this is how readily humans as a species fail to feel compassion for those who are of different races, cultures, and clans. Austen's subject matter is very much our own, and so contributes to our sense of a shared framework of feeling and experience. Austen famously claimed to work on 2 inches of ivory with a fine brush, creating a world that traces the intricacies of human interaction rather than the breadth of human endeavor. She concentrates on interpersonal relationships, an aspect of human life that's universal. All of Austen's heroines embark on a search for intimacy with a trustworthy person who can be both a lover and a friend. The allies and adversaries they encounter along the way include personalities of all kinds, rather than the monsters and warriors typical of the hero's quest. Such human universals explain why we can relate to literature of many different cultures. Literary critics argue that realism, the extent to which literature can feel true to life, consists of conventions that vary from culture to culture. Nevertheless, some aspects of being human are universal, and we tend to be able to accept the portrayal of such universals as true to life and meaningful, even when they're set in times and places remote from our own. The literary scholar Patrick Hogan has found that love stories are told in cultures throughout the world, and that the same situations and emotions tend to appear within those stories, no matter where or when they were written. We might find much about the Latin classic The Aeneid alien and even alienating, but we can still identify with Dido's heartbreak when her lover Aeneas abandons her. Austen concentrates on this world of ubiquitous feelings and perceptions. Not only does Austen tell stories of love and friendship, of the sort shared by people everywhere, but these take cultural forms that are still easily recognizable to us, our vast advances in technology notwithstanding. We still live in families. We still interact with circles of friends, acquaintances, and colleagues. Marriage and other kinds of intimate partnership are very much a goal for many of us. Austen couldn't completely anticipate our world, nor transcend many of the limitations of her day. She was insightful, but not clairvoyant. And so she writes about universal topics with a limited cast of characters: heterosexual, Caucasian, upper and middle class families. Some find her off-putting because of this. But many readers are willing to forgive her for being of her age. They recognize her value, as demonstrated by the breadth and diversity of her global readership. I think her attitudes were progressive, given the limitations of her milieu, and that her insights have value for all of us, even if they weren't written with all of us in mind. But that's a personal decision. Austen's style remains as accessible as her stories. She writes in pithy, crystal-clear sentences, creating novels that are paced quickly enough even for our impatient 21st-century sensibilities. In Austen, the heart of the matter, which is indeed the matter of the heart, is right there. We don't have to penetrate layers of cultural and stylistic difference to get at it. Because Austen creates a world that has much common ground with our own, there's a strong foundation for empathy. Austen's stories not only convey empathy through mirroring and identification, but they're about empathy as well. Who has it? Who lacks it? And how some of her characters deepen their capacity for this important quality. Her novels get us to focus on the experience of empathy. Neuroscientists would say they prime us to think about it, by showing its value repeatedly. So we find ourselves reflected in novels that are all about the value of being able to find yourself reflected in other minds and hearts. Yet we're not fascinated by empathy because it's brought to our attention, but rather we pay attention because empathy is essential to our well-being. And this is yet another reason we're drawn to Austen. She understands this about us. Perhaps it seems strange to characterize Austen's novels as being about empathy. After all, Austen's great subject is love. Its different varieties, its frustrations, its nuances, and above all, its satisfactions. And not just love between couples, but also between friends, parents and children, siblings. Austen certainly understood this most precious of human emotional resources. But there's no contradiction here. Austen's novels show again and again that the most complete and satisfying relationships rely on perspective taking, understanding, and emotional resonance. Whatever its other features, gratitude, esteem, passion, nurturing, at its core, true love is empathy. Think about all of Austen's happy couples, and you'll see that this is the case. Anne of Persuasion might be more intuitive and passionate than Elizabeth of Pride and Prejudice. But sensitivity and understanding lead to happy endings for both of them. In placing empathy front and center, Austen knew what she was doing. For Austen is no mere copyist of nature, but a deeply thoughtful novelist who explores the morality as well as the psychology of the social brain, those aspects of the mind-brain that imbue our relationships. This was brought home to me recently when I tried to read the novelist Georgette Heyer, a 20th century writer who emulated Austen. Here were all the window dressings of Austen's fiction, the masterpiece theater costumes, plots, and themes, but hollowed out, not only of Austen's distinctively brilliant style, but also of her philosophical and psychological depth. With apologies to all the Austen fans who cut their teeth on Heyer, I found her unreadable. In the humble guise of the novel of manners, a genre that focuses on social conduct, Austen's work draws out the moral implications of being human. What do we owe one another ethically, and how do we go about fulfilling this obligation? The simple answer? We owe one another the kinds of consideration and treatment that help all of us not only to satisfy our basic needs, but to achieve well-being and self-esteem. And this depends on empathy, the key to understanding another person's needs. And so Emma caters to her needy, hypochondriacal, and often ridiculous father in Emma. So Edmund becomes young Fanny's friend and advocate in Mansfield Park. So Elizabeth in Pride and Prejudice tolerates the more absurd members of her family with calm consideration. In that last family, we might note that it's with regard to this fundamental ethical obligation that Mr. Bennet fails so completely. Rather than helping his foolish wife to develop whatever potential she might have, he retreats to sarcasm to console himself for having to endure her company. As a result, she remains as silly as ever, learning only to ignore a husband she can't understand and who doesn't empathize with her. When Austen's characters demonstrate kindness and tolerance, it's because they're able to imagine and sympathize with life from the point of view of others. Emma indulges her father's many absurdities because she can see that his worries are real to him. Edmund imagines what it's like to be young, lonely, and intimidated in a new place, and so he's kind to Fanny. Elizabeth knows that she might not be able to change her mother, but that failing to show her respect would be hurtful and accomplish nothing. Austen's best heroine, Anne Elliot of Persuasion, owes her goodness and capability to her capacity for empathy. She can see from others' perspectives, and this guides her feelings and behavior. As Wentworth, the man she loves, eventually realizes, there is no one so proper, so capable as Anne. For Austen, empathy is the core quality of all moral action. Here, Austen agrees with the philosopher David Hume, a near contemporary. In our own day, similar conclusions have been advanced by Simon Baron Cohen, a neuroscientist who equates evil with a lack of empathy. And Franz Duval, a philosopher and primatologist, who views our capacity for moral action as grounded in empathy, which we find in less developed forms in other primates. Above and beyond the kindness and understanding that empathy creates, it's valuable because it unlocks the prison house of cosmic loneliness that threatens each of us with a life sentence of solitary confinement. Anglo-European politics, philosophy, and psychology have emphasized our separateness, condemned us without a trial, insisting that we're stuck in a container, the body, looking out through windows, the eyes. We're born alone and we die alone, even if other people are near us for these two defining events in the life cycle of every human. But the latest work in social intelligence tells us that we're profoundly interconnected in terms of brain, body, and mind. This has been a key insight of the literary imagination all along, that fund of wisdom and observation found in literature. In terms of understanding our connections with one another, no author is greater than Austen. And she shows that such connections depend on empathy, on being able to enter into the thoughts and feelings of others. Through such exchanges, people find meaning and purpose in their lives. Explaining Austen's appeal in terms of empathy made sense to me, but as with all literary theories, and many scientific ones as well, If truth be told, supporting my hunch was another matter. While I realized I could never definitively prove my claims, I began to wonder if I could nevertheless offer convincing evidence. My take on the intense devotion Austen inspires hinges on the observation that Austen gets us, that she understands us and captures our attention because she gets us right, creating fictional people whom real people find extraordinarily true to life. As I became progressively more interested in the mind and the brain, I began to realize that I could make a case for Austen's accuracy in portraying human nature by drawing on various findings in the mind-brain sciences, fields that include psychology, cognitive science, and neuroscience. I could show that Austen's characters are true to what we know about social intelligence and the social mind-brain to support the claim that Austen's appeal lies in her powers of empathy. And if these scientific fields could be applied in support of a literary theory, that Austen's empathy is conveyed by her ability to portray people realistically, then literature could also be drafted in the service of science. Austen's accuracy in representing feelings and relationships makes her work ideal for discussing social intelligence, that aspect of being human that most concerned Austen herself, how people relate to one another. Austen's characters provide imaginary case histories that illustrate the workings of the social mind-brain. These two stories, one about social intelligence and the other about Austen's fiction, define one another in yin-yang fashion. As far as I know, all the books that discuss Austen's fiction or her appeal invoke the psychology of her characters in one way or another. My book is no exception, but I go one step further, discussing her characters in depth but with a difference, peering beneath the surface of the mind into the anatomy and neurochemistry of the brain. I like to think about this with a metaphor. Recall those children's books on human anatomy with transparencies overlaid, so that each time you turn a page, you go deeper into the human body, beginning with skin and hair until you're staring at the viscera. I view my book as this kind of a page-turner. I look at social intelligence through the psychological analysis of Austen's characters, but then turn the page to find what lies beneath their physiology. For those who approach this book because they're interested in literature, I hope you'll see this favorite author in a new light while learning about a topic that might not be familiar. For those who are interested in the mind-brain sciences, I hope that you'll enjoy reading a book in this field told largely by lively and interesting fictional people. Perhaps you'll read more of Austen's work. I hope that so-called general listeners, who are general only in the sense that they generally know more about most things than the rest of us, will find something new to enjoy. For all my listeners, I hope that hearing knowledge about the mind and the brain within the very human context of Austen's characters will yield new insights about your own feelings, relationships, and choices. The die-hard Austen fans will be able to add yet another way in which this favorite author is extraordinary. Yet one more honor for our beloved Jane. In addition to the pleasure and wisdom she bequeathed, she gave us some of our most memorable lessons in social intelligence. 1. Precious feelings. Tell me not that I am too late, that such precious feelings are gone forever. Frederick Wentworth in Persuasion. Elizabeth Bennet's feelings have betrayed her, or so she thinks. But this is when she is still many months and many pages away from the happy ending of Pride and Prejudice that will unite her with Fitzwilliam Darcy. It's the morning after Darcy's first proposal, an offer made in highly insulting terms. Darcy confessed that he was asking Elizabeth to marry him against his will, his reason, and his character, and that their marriage would mean connecting himself with a family that, with the exception of Elizabeth and her sister Jane, deserves the contempt that he so clearly and abundantly feels for them. He spoke well, but there were feelings besides those of the heart to be detailed, and he was not more eloquent on the subject of tenderness than of pride. Elizabeth was furious, and she rejected Darcy in no uncertain terms as the last man in the world whom I could ever be prevailed on to marry. Elizabeth has good reasons for disliking Darcy, as she tells him. In addition to the rudeness of his proposal, he made her sister Jane miserable by convincing his friend Bingley that Jane was indifferent to him, and so keeping the couple apart. And Elizabeth believes, as her friend Wickham told her, that Darcy had cheated him out of an inheritance that was rightfully his. And on a very personal note, she keeps this to herself, he insulted her when they first met at the Meryton ball, saying within her hearing that she wasn't handsome enough to tempt him to dance. Elizabeth's wounding retort to her would-be lover, "You are mistaken, Mr. Darcy, if you suppose that the mode of your declaration affected me in any other way than as it spared me the concern which I might have felt in refusing you had you behaved in a more gentlemanlike manner." This is the ultimate insult for an aristocrat like Darcy, who prides himself on being a gentleman. Darcy was too furious and shocked to reply to Elizabeth in that moment, but he sent a letter the following day, answering Elizabeth's charges and certainly exonerating himself on the subject of his poor treatment of Wickham. Far from having deprived Wickham of a rightful bequest, Darcy gave him a generous amount of money to pursue his studies. Wickham had claimed to want to be a lawyer. When the money ran out, spent in idleness and dissipation, it's doubtful Wickham ever opened a law book, Darcy refused further aid. Wickham soon after attempted to elope with Darcy's younger sister, attracted both by her inheritance of £30,000 and the prospect of wounding Darcy where it would hurt the most. Elizabeth is mortified. How could she have been so wrong? She blames her feelings. Had I been in love, I could not have been more wretchedly blind, pleased with the preference of one, Wickham, and offended by the neglect of the other, Darcy. On the very beginning of our acquaintance, I have courted prepossession and ignorance, and driven reason away where either were concerned. But Elizabeth is harder on herself and her feelings than she ought to be, because her dislike of Darcy is actually justified. Although he's behaved himself relatively well since their first disastrous meeting, his proposal of marriage is truly obnoxious. However insufferable Elizabeth's family might be, Darcy's condescension and bluntness make him as rude and insensitive as they are, without the excuse of stupidity. Elizabeth is right to reject Darcy's proposal. He doesn't behave as a gentleman should behave toward the woman he loves. Imagine for a moment if Elizabeth hadn't had the feelings that caused her to reject Darcy, or if she'd suppressed or ignored her resentment. Imagine if she'd accepted his first proposal. Imagine what it would be like to be married to a man who thought that his marrying you was a huge favor for which you ought to be forever grateful, a favor that canceled out any faults in him you might perceive, and which exacted total submission on your part in return. This wouldn't have been good for Elizabeth, and it wouldn't have been good for Darcy. Without the ballast of Elizabeth's corrective influence, without her unexpected and feisty rejection, he might have turned out to be a more intelligent, if equally loathsome, version of his snobbish aunt, Lady Catherine de Bourgh. Instead, by the end of the novel, Darcy has rethought his attitudes and begun to act accordingly. He's a better man. Elizabeth's feelings enabled her to judge a situation correctly, even if she was wrong on some of its details, and to choose the course of action that would be in her best interests. Feelings gave her vital information about how to act at a crucial moment, reject Darcy. This isn't to say that Austen claims that feelings are a foolproof guide, goodness knows. When they mislead us, they can do so spectacularly. Elizabeth's sister Lydia demonstrates the dangers of being thoughtlessly guided by feelings when she elopes with Wickham. Of course, Darcy saves the day, and this brings him together with Elizabeth. But these benefits don't cancel out the inherently disastrous nature of Lydia's behavior. Like all potentially volatile substances, feelings must be handled with care, assessed and regulated. You should think long and hard before indulging strong impulses. Even so, in Austen's world, as in real life, feelings are valuable for what they tell us, both about ourselves and about others. What we talk about when we talk about feelings. Although definitions of emotion vary, most psychologists agree with Austen that they're a means of appraisal, of assessing whether something or someone is good or bad, as we see with Elizabeth. They convey valuable information that influences our responses to our inner as well as outer environments, to thoughts and memories as well as to people and events. And they instigate action as well as thought. We often behave in ways that express our feelings. Like Austen, mind-brain scientists don't claim that emotions are a foolproof guide. But nothing in the human brain is foolproof. Feelings must have helped our ancestors survive more often than not, because the capacity for emotion has been retained throughout the evolution of mammals. We're simply among the latest heirs. I especially like neuroscientist Edmund Rolls's definition of emotion because it clearly indicates that emotions are active responses to situations and environments. Emotions are states elicited by rewards and punishers. A reward is something for which an animal, including, of course, a human, will work. A punisher is something that an animal will work to escape or avoid, or that will decrease the probability of actions on which it is contingent. Rawls characterizes emotion as a dynamic force that enables us to achieve both tangible and intangible benefits. Food and sex are among the most basic material rewards that animals, including human animals, work to obtain. But Rawls's definition additionally accounts for many of the complicated forms of feeling that have the quality of drives, such as ambition. Ambition isn't a simple response like fear, but it nevertheless shares its evaluative and goal-directed characteristics. Indeed, all kinds of emotions ideally help us to work for rewards and avoid punishers. In the first proposal scene, Darcy is clearly a punisher, although he later becomes a very satisfying reward. Understanding how emotions function neurologically provides a firm foundation for understanding how they work psychologically, in personal reactions, and in our social exchanges with one another. In order to shed light on emotional processing, neuroscientist Joseph Ledoux has studied the neural pathways, the routes taken by electrical signals that travel along our nerves, called neurons, of what might well be the most basic of emotions, fear. Fear is very likely a universal emotion, and with good reason. It helps animals, including human animals, to survive. Ledoux studied rats rather than humans because he could use research tools that are considered unethical for our species, such as implanting electrodes in the brain and breeding for specific traits. And despite the greater complexity of human brains, it's sound scientific practice to use the brains of other mammals to learn about humans because we share much of their basic neural circuitry. As the human brain evolved, it incorporated and built on the anatomy from which it emerged. Even the human cortex, the crinkly outermost layer of the brain that enables our higher functions, evolved from the simpler cortex that reptiles possess. Ledoux proposes that in the mammalian brain, a fear response takes two pathways, which he calls the low road and the high road. Both lead to the amygdala, an almond-shaped emotion processing area deep within the middle of the brain, inside the wrapping of the cortex. The amygdala turns on the fear response as well as other types of excitatory reactions. It's what gets our adrenaline pumping, and it was surely very active for Elizabeth as she listened to Darcy's proposal. By the way, Ledoux's work on the function of the amygdala has found creative as well as scientific expression. He plays with a rock band called the Amygdaloids. Given the quality of classic rock to appeal viscerally and directly to our feelings, the band is appropriately named. Ledoux illustrates the circuitry of fear with an example that has become classic in the literature of neuroscience. Let's say you're hiking along a trail, and you encounter something long and thin that might be a snake. You're not sure. In order to see whether or not this is really a snake, nerve signals must reach the visual cortex, which is the brain's highest visual processing region, the part necessary for sight. But there are visual areas below the cortex in the brainstem, the brain's lowest processing area. Most visual signals pass through these brainstem areas and continue on to eventually be processed by the visual cortex. But some of these signals take another path, traveling directly from the brainstem to the amygdala. This has two results. You see without knowing you see. Such subconscious subcortical sensory perception is known as neuroception, and when it involves vision, it's also called blindsight. The image formed in subcortical, neuroceptive areas is not a clear, detailed image, since visual impulses haven't completed their journey to the visual cortex, where sensory information is assembled in its final form. Nor are you consciously aware of what you're seeing, or even that you're seeing. Of interest to the social brain, Beatrice de Gelder and her colleagues found that blindsight can detect emotional expression on a person's face, although not a person's identity. That is, blindsight excludes facial recognition, nor can it detect gender. Nevertheless, the amygdala learns that there's something long and thin that might be a snake, and it initiates a fear response. And so before your conscious mind even registers what you see or even knows you have something to be afraid of, your body begins to prepare for fight or flight, for defending yourself against an enemy or running away to safety. Heart rate increases and stress hormones course through the bloodstream, along with other bodily changes. Your eyes will probably widen, an expression of fear. This is the low road, from sight receptors to the amygdala. Most visual signals travel the high road, which refers to cortical pathways, strings of connected neurons that lead from the eyes to the visual cortex, where an accurate and fully conscious perception of what is being viewed is assembled. This occurs only milliseconds after the low road information has reached the amygdala. You now know exactly whether there's a stick or a rattlesnake in your path. With information coming from the high road, a signal can be sent to the amygdala that tells it to either continue generating the fear that will help you survive, or to halt its red alert because you're safe. Through the moment when you experience your fear, your reaction matches those of other mammals, including Ledoux's rats. Conscious areas of the brain, mostly cortical areas, read the activity that's going on subconsciously and subcortically and translate it into experience. At this point, whether you're a man or a mouse, your emotional response has been transformed into a feeling. You feel your fear. But if you're human, you'll also become aware of your fear in a self-reflective way, and if all is safe, aware of your relief. Moreover, you can still feel fear without having to act on it, or else act on it immediately as you assess the situation accordingly. This might also be true for other great apes, and perhaps some other mammals such as elephants and dolphins. Because you can name or think abstractly about what you're feeling, mind-brain scientists refer to such recognition as symbolic thinking. It can be put into words or images which symbolize actual experience. Although high road information completes its path only milliseconds after the low road information has reached the amygdala, in the wild, where we evolved, such small quantities of time can determine whether we live or die. If you had to wait until your conscious mind registered a given situation, such as a poisonous snake in your path, it might be too late to marshal the bodily resources needed for coping successfully. Because information has traveled the low road, by the time your higher brain areas realize what's going on and decide on a plan, the body is ready with adrenaline already activated to make your muscles do the extra work needed for running away or fighting. In fact, you might begin to run before you fully register the situation, before you know whether there's a poisonous snake, a harmless snake, or a fallen branch in your path. Perhaps you've had the experience of feeling your startle reflex kick in, even as you realize that there's nothing to be afraid of. This experience demonstrates the workings of the two roads. This has certainly happened to me. I have a rather sensitive startle reflex, the mark of a nervous person. Once I was sitting in a chair reading when my cat Jemima came up behind me. I jumped, the physiological emotional response appropriate to fear and surprise, at the very same time that I was saying to myself, "It's only Jemima." I don't know what danger signal was sent to my amygdala, perhaps a very ancient biologically ingrained response to the possibility of a predator creeping up on me through the grass. It was the oddest experience, to feel my body generating a physical fear response, even as my mind was noting the absence of danger. My low road response had already been initiated and was ongoing when the high road response completed its course. The usefulness of the dual pathway is most obvious with an emotion like fear. And it's possible that other emotions, at least negative ones, follow a similar pattern because it was established by certain primal responses that helped us to survive. In any case, emotions are subconscious reactions that consist largely of physiological responses. Whether we eventually consciously realize this or not, bodily reaction is the calling card of emotional response, and it precedes our conscious knowledge of our own feelings. Jane Austen, Emotion Scientist, Emotions and Feelings. I've been speaking of emotion and feeling as synonymous, without distinguishing a difference, as we tend to do in everyday speech. But mind-brain scientists make an important distinction, even if they don't always agree on terminology. Emotions refer to subcortical and subconscious neural signals that subsequently travel on to higher brain areas. Feelings refer to our recognition of emotions. They're what we experience when emotions reach those higher cortical areas. As mammals, first we respond, then we feel, translating a mind-body response into a conscious perception. A few species among us have self-awareness. We understand that we feel. We're used to encountering descriptions of feelings in novels. Feelings tend to be the stock in trade of the genre. We find it entirely natural for a narrator to enter the minds of characters in order to follow their reactions to events. But Austen, with her extraordinary, one might say clinical, powers of observation, captures emotion accurately as well, the initial subcortical and bodily response to experience, which is much more unusual. We see this when Darcy unexpectedly encounters Elizabeth and her relatives, the Gardiners, touring Pemberley, his family estate. Tourism of great estates had begun in the 18th century, and a pleasure trip such as the Gardiners and Elizabeth are taking would have included such stops. They had been assured that the family was absent. Elizabeth's last encounter with Darcy had taken place when she rejected his proposal of marriage, and he'd sent the explanatory letter that shamed Elizabeth by revealing that she'd been a poor judge of character. She would certainly not have agreed to go to Pemberley if she thought there was a chance of meeting Darcy, but this is exactly what happens. As they walked across the lawn towards the river, Elizabeth turned back to look again. Her uncle and aunt stopped also, and while the former was conjecturing as to the date of the building, the owner of it himself suddenly came forward from the road, which led behind it to the stables. They were within 20 yards of each other, and so abrupt was his appearance, that it was impossible to avoid his sight. Their eyes instantly met, and the cheeks of each were overspread with the deepest blush. He absolutely started, and for a moment seemed immovable from surprise, but shortly recovering himself, advanced toward the party and spoke to Elizabeth, if not in terms of perfect composure, at least of perfect civility. She had instinctively turned away, but stopped on his approach, received his compliments with an embarrassment impossible to be overcome. The emotional nature of this encounter is conveyed by the presence of telltale bodily signs. Darcy starts, as I did with my cat, a reaction that often accompanies surprise, an emotion that has affinities with fear. Darcy displays another distinctive fear-surprise response. He freezes. Both Elizabeth and Darcy are embarrassed, as we see from the deepest blush that suffuses their faces. And Elizabeth instinctively turns away, the hallmark gesture of shame, even seen in infants when they experience a rudimentary form of this emotion. These responses are instrumental in informing Elizabeth and Darcy of how they feel about meeting, terribly embarrassed. And this knowledge guides their actions. Feelings as well as emotions help us to work for rewards and avoid punishers. Embarrassment lets them know that they're confronting a delicate situation and that they must behave appropriately. The reward they work toward is a reduction of embarrassment, as well as the chance to repair past misconceptions and misbehavior. The punisher they avoid is continued discomfort and awkwardness. Darcy steps forward graciously, and Elizabeth responds in kind, with her best manners. We see emotion and feeling doing their job, telling minds and bodies how to behave appropriately, to lessen, if not dodge, punishers, and hopefully, to reap rewards. Emotions and feelings convey important information not only to the people experiencing them, but to others as well. This is true for all animals, including humans. Of course, for us, language is a vital component of communication, one of the biosocial advantages that have made our species dominant. But we rely on non-linguistic communication, called social signaling, to a greater extent than many of us realize. Social signals include gestures, facial expressions, posture, and vocal inflections, such as tone, volume, and emphasis, known as vocal prosody, as opposed to linguistic content. Many of these signals, such as blushes and tears, are involuntary products of the physiological nature of emotion. Although such signals often occur when we're by ourselves, they're known as social signals because of their vital role in social situations. They might be absent or, more likely, muted when you're alone. Social signals are a powerful means of communication, as important as speech. Watch a movie in an unfamiliar language with the subtitles off. You'll be surprised at how much you're able to understand. Needless to say, people can disguise their social signaling. Our cognitive talents have made us masters of deceit. But their more positive purpose is to reveal rather than deceive, and we share this feature with other mammals. Elizabeth and Darcy's encounter at Pemberley illustrates the display as well as the appraisal function of emotion. The blush that Darcy and Elizabeth both so wish to avoid sends an important message. They know that they share similar responses and that no one has the upper hand. Of course, Austen might have told her readers what Elizabeth and Darcy were feeling at Pemberley without any physical description at all by eavesdropping on their thoughts, a convention Austen and most other third-person narrators frequently use. But fictional people obviously can't do the same, any more than real people can. They use social signals and speech to assess those around them. Austen shows the value of a nonverbal exchange between Elizabeth and Darcy at a crucial moment in their relationship. Such signals might have been even more vital in Austen's very polite society than in our own less inhibited culture. Information that couldn't be spoken was often expressed through these tacit channels. and Austen is a master of showing the importance of nonverbal signs. She understands that what people miss seeing or fail to communicate can be as important as the signals that are successfully conveyed. If Elizabeth had read Darcy's social signals more accurately during her brief stay at Bingley's house, where she and Jane were forced to remain for a few days because Jane caught a fever, she would have known that he was attracted to her and been more prepared to deal with his confession of love. Darcy can't take his eyes off Elizabeth, a pointed clue as to his feelings. Another even more crucial instance, Elizabeth's sister Jane is deeply in love with Darcy's friend Bingley. But the mismatch between her congenial, low-key manner and the intensity of her love prompts others, including Darcy, to mistake her feelings. Elizabeth believes that such reticence is one of her sister's strengths, and that her calm manner protects her privacy. But Elizabeth's friend Charlotte warns that Jane needs to be more obvious about her feelings, or she'll risk losing Bingley. If a woman conceals her affection from the man she loves, it will then be but poor consolation to believe the world equally in the dark. This is indeed what happens. Darcy feels justified in separating Bingley and Jane because he hasn't observed strong feelings on Jane's part. And Bingley, although in love with Jane, agrees to relinquish his hope of marrying her because he also fails to see cues that reveal the strength of her feelings. Absent or misleading social signals can be just as harmful as saying the wrong thing. Jane Austen, Emotion Scientist, Mood and Personality. As readers of Austen well know, her novels consist largely of following trajectories of feelings as new experiences confront her heroines and other characters. But she's also acutely aware of the role of more sustained kinds of what's called affect, the general term in mind-brain science for responses that involve appraisal and evaluation. Temperament, more often called personality these days, refers to characteristic ways of responding emotionally. Bingley's willingness to relinquish Jane stems from temperament as well as uncertainty about her feelings. He's modest and gentle, whereas Darcy is confident and, in certain situations, assertive to a fault. And so Bingley often bows to the judgment of his forceful friend. Psychologists Robert McCrae and Paul Costa define personality as consisting of five categories and their opposites: openness to experience, conscientiousness, undirectedness, extroversion, agreeableness, antagonism, and neuroticism, which means a tendency to experience negative emotions easily and to feel nervous and anxious. These can be used to further characterize Darcy. He's certainly conscientious, which makes him a bit too serious, and he's also introverted, which makes him appear disagreeable at times. Indeed, his shyness is as responsible as his snobbery for his haughty demeanor. Others misread his cues, and so his introverted behavior is taken for rudeness, making him seem even more intolerant and intolerable than he really is. He's somewhat closed to new experiences, although we can't blame all of his self-containment on an aversion to novelty. He certainly sees enough very quickly at the Meryton Ball, where eligible bachelors appear to be the door prize, to allow him to make an informed decision to avoid making friends in this company. No doubt he's high-strung, which means he doesn't take things lightly or in stride. Some personality traits appear to be innate, and shyness is one of these, although a person's environment can have a huge influence in altering natural tendencies. With a different kind of upbringing, Darcy might have been less anxious around others, despite a tendency toward introversion. We can easily see the difference in temperament between Darcy and Bingley in their respective attitudes toward the Meryton Ball. There's a lot there that's off-putting, but also much that's positive, such as Elizabeth herself, as Darcy later comes to realize. Yet temperament influences each man's experience. Bingley had never met with pleasanter people or prettier girls in his life. Everybody had been most kind and attentive to him. There had been no formality, no stiffness. He had soon felt acquainted with all in the room. And as to Miss Bennet, he could not conceive an angel more beautiful. Darcy, on the contrary, had seen a collection of people in whom there was little beauty and no fashion, for none of whom he had felt the smallest interest, and from none received either attention or pleasure. Miss Bennet, Jane, he acknowledged to be pretty, but she smiled too much. Bingley and Darcy attend very different balls at Meryton, although they're both present in the same place at the same time. Temperament makes the ball an enjoyable event for Bingley and a zone of endurance for Darcy. Temperament also helps make the world each of these men inhabits, as it does with all of us. Bingley is pleasant, and so he brings out the best in people. Darcy's haughty behavior invokes the negativity he feels in people's responses to him. Mood refers to an emotional state that's longer lasting than emotion or feeling, but it's not as enduring as characteristics of personality. Darcy refers to moods when he tells Bingley why he won't ask Elizabeth to dance at the Meryton ball. I am in no humor at present to give consequence to young ladies who are slighted by other men. He implies that in a different mood he might have been more polite, and this is true to some extent, for his behavior toward Elizabeth quickly changes as his feelings for her develop. Even so, Darcy's statement reveals as much about his temperament as it does about his mood. It's a particularly clever choice on Austen's part to have Darcy use the word humor. I am in no humor at present. Because in her day, humor could mean either mood or temperament. The word humor derives from medieval and Renaissance physiology. It was thought that the body consisted of four chief fluids called humors, each associated with a different personality trait. While the theory of the humors had been discredited by Austen's time, the use of the word humor to mean personality lingered on, a meaning it has lost in our own day. But it had also come to refer primarily to mood, as it still does. So when Darcy uses humor to mean a temporary state of mind, he inadvertently admits that his antisocial stance is more than a temporary mood, and that it's natural for him to be in no humor to dance or to make an effort to extend himself in social situations. Austen's choice of a word with competing definitions tells her readers that Darcy's discomfort with social situations is habitual rather than passing, although he's particularly grumpy at this moment. More like fleeting forms of affect, both mood and personality initially help us to attain rewards and avoid punishers, although given the complexity of the human brain, there's plenty of room for error at all levels. Nevertheless, the basic principle that the role of affect is to steer us toward the best course of action still applies, even when this is difficult to see. People sometimes possess unhelpful characteristics because these were useful at an earlier time in their lives, possibly the best response to a bad set of options. By being deployed regularly, they become ingrained responses. For instance, some children with emotionally distant parents learn to shun intimacy in order to avoid being disappointed. You might easily imagine that Darcy experienced this kind of upbringing. It is also true that what might appear to be a negative characteristic from one perspective might well have benefits that aren't immediately obvious. Take Darcy's bad humor at Meryton, which appears to lead to behavior with no redeeming features, at least to Elizabeth's way of thinking. Folk wisdom agrees, telling us that we catch more flies with honey than vinegar, and Darcy is certainly all vinegar. But Darcy doesn't want to catch flies. And indeed, the inhabitants of Meryton and nearby villages are ready to swarm around him for the honey he has to offer, in the form of a large fortune and meritable eligibility. So his bad humor keeps him from having to interact with a crowd of people with whom he has no wish to be better acquainted. In fact, it's likely that given his position, a bad mood serves Darcy well much of the time. It certainly keeps his admirer, Miss Bingley, at a distance. And quite honestly, only someone as good-natured as Bingley could have endured the evening at Meryton with such sustained good cheer and a positive outlook. Darcy quickly sees enough at Meryton, including the behavior of Elizabeth's silly mother and even sillier sisters, Lydia, Kitty, and Mary, to put him in a bad humor. Human beings, human feelings. It's widely accepted within the mind-brain sciences that we possess basic emotions, that everyone is born with the capacity for certain physiological, psychological responses that are genetically designed to begin working within the first 2 years of life. While scientists disagree about the number and identity of these emotions, the standard list in Western mind-brain science includes anger, fear, disgust, sadness, happiness, and surprise. According to basic emotion theory, all other emotions develop from these fundamental categories. This is definitely the reigning paradigm. Open just about any textbook on psychology or cognitive science or neuroscience, and this is the account of emotion you'll find. Facial expression provides support for basic emotion theory. Psychologist Paul Ekman spent a year looking at his face in the mirror in order to identify all the muscles involved in facial expression and match them to specific emotions. Applying this knowledge in the field, Ekman found that certain facial expressions consistently correlate with specific emotions across a wide range of cultures. Some emotions do appear to be universal. Basic emotion theorists maintain that while a given facial expression might carry a range of meanings, this doesn't contradict the essential nature of basic emotions. For instance, a smile can convey qualitatively different categories of happiness. The happiness of being with a loved one, the happiness of relief, the happiness of achieving a goal, the happiness of triumph, and so forth. Jane's smile when she sees Bingley is very different from Elizabeth's smile as she listens to the folly of her neighbors. Be this as it may, all these instances have a common denominator, a happiness factor. No one smiles as an expression of sadness. Although you can smile if you're feeling a mixture of happiness and sadness, you're smiling at the happy part. Even a nervous smile or laugh expresses your sense that you've done something funny, something other people might laugh at or find funny peculiar. While we're one of the few species who possess the muscles needed to smile, we certainly aren't the only creatures with emotions. Psychologist Jak Pongsep explains that because our emotional systems are the product of evolution, we share the circuitry for basic emotions with other mammals. Pongsep actually categorizes emotions in terms of basic systems rather than single emotions. These include seeking, rage, fear, lust, care, panic, grief, and play. But the principle is still the same. We're born genetically endowed to develop basic circuitry for emotional responses, a capacity shared by all mammals. By the way, Pongsep has been nicknamed the rat tickler in scientific circles because he discovered that rats actually laugh when they're tickled. You can watch Pongsep tickle rats at https://www.youtube.com/watch?v=sign=j-adm-r-g-f-n-m. Precursors of emotion can be found in much more primitive animals, as you'll see when you meet the giant snail Aplysia in a future chapter. Nevertheless, there are emotions that are not basic, that are found in humans and likely some other species, but which are not ubiquitous among mammals. Embarrassment is one such non-basic emotion. Unlike fear, which all neurologically intact mammals are capable of experiencing, embarrassment involves knowing or imagining a witness to your actions or feelings. It also appears to know rules about what's acceptable or unacceptable, rules that are conveyed through language or other symbolic forms of communication. Yet despite its origins in a higher level of awareness than many other mammals are capable of, embarrassment is an emotion, a learned emotion, but an emotion nevertheless. Its physiological signature, the blush, indicates the activity of the autonomic nervous system, which controls involuntary bodily responses. This subconscious physiological reaction makes it as much an emotion as fear. Embarrassment is definitely the emotion shared by Elizabeth and Darcy when they meet at Pemberley, because they each recall their last meeting and the turbulent feelings that accompanied the ill-fated proposal. Neither wants to be reminded of this awkward encounter, especially in public. Darcy would rather not be reminded of Elizabeth's rejection, nor her accurate assessment of his ungentlemanly behavior. Elizabeth doesn't want to be reminded of her lack of judgment or her loss of temper. Each was a witness to the other at a particularly unflattering moment, and so they're embarrassed. Such a sophisticated and non-basic emotion like embarrassment might be limited to animals with highly developed social capabilities. Perhaps only humans feel embarrassment. In contrast, when my cat Jemima startled me, another unexpected meeting, I might as well just have been another cat as a human. Another animal crept up behind me, and I reacted as any mammal would, startling with surprise and fear. But if Jemima were to meet another kitty who'd rejected her amorous advances, she wouldn't feel embarrassed. Pemberley doesn't happen in the kitty world. The complexity of the human brain might also explain why some non-basic emotions might be culturally specific. Emotion scientists cite the Japanese emotion called amai, which many claim we lack in our more individualistically oriented Western societies. Amai refers to the sense of well-being that comes from feeling that you're completely part of another person or group of people, especially when you're dependent on that person or group. Amai, experienced as an emotion, that is, subconsciously, generates a calm or happy feeling linked to the sense of dependency. A person reflecting on the feelings of amai would realize that he felt good as a result of being close and dependent on someone else. However, there's controversy about how exactly to define amai and whether it is a culturally distinct emotion. People in Western societies very likely do experience amai, although we don't have a name for it. This suggests that emotions that aren't recognized within a given culture might nevertheless be felt. Perhaps in our individualistic society, with its worship of autonomy, we'd rather not admit to feelings that undermine self-reliance. In any case, amai, like embarrassment, is not a basic emotion. Psychologist Lisa Feldman Barrett rejects basic emotion theory altogether. She's certainly not the only one to have done this. In the past 30 years, it's been criticized repeatedly in the scholarly literature. But Barrett's work is in the forefront of challenges to basic emotion theory and has garnered attention and prestige equal to that of the mind-brain scientists whose theories she challenges. Barrett argues that emotions are dimensional rather than basic. This means that they're brain-body activations that tag experience in terms of value and arousal, whether you feel good or bad about something, and whether your feelings are strong or weak. Barrett maintains that emotions consist of ongoing neural and physiological changes in this fuzzy dimensional sense, in response to the stream of people, events, and thoughts that we encounter each moment. If you're mathematically inclined, you might think of graphing a given emotional response along an XY axis, with X being equivalent to value and Y to arousal. Responses would then involve changes in position within the space of the graph. Emotions would achieve their specific features only after reaching consciousness, on being experienced as feelings. We can view a dimensional theory of emotion in terms of the emotion-feeling distinction. Emotions emerge in our bodies and subconscious brains, and our conscious minds subsequently experience and label them. To see how this works, let's look again at Elizabeth's insights after receiving Darcy's post-proposal letter. In retrospect, she understands that, pleased with the preference of one, Wickham, and offended with the neglect of the other, Darcy, I have courted prepossession and ignorance, and driven reason away where either of the two men were concerned. Notice that the word pleased refers to feelings that are strong and positive, offended to feelings that are strong and negative. But these words fail to capture nuances of response. Pleased and offended are broad descriptive terms. An array of positive emotions can contribute to feeling pleased, including feeling flattered, proud, happy, vindicated. Offended can mean hurt, disgusted, disapproving, shocked. These lists are partial, and I'm sure you can think of many other kinds of feelings that fit these umbrella terms. With similar imprecision, the narrator describes Elizabeth's reactions to the letter itself as difficult of definition. Astonishment, apprehension, and even horror oppressed her. The narrator appears to grope for words in order to pinpoint a reaction that is, to begin with, much more formless. But again, the description might well embrace nuances of feeling that contribute to Elizabeth's astonishment, apprehension, and even horror, such as embarrassment and regret. The general terms in which Elizabeth's feelings are described by both herself and the narrator might be seen as evidence in support of Barrett's view that emotions, our initial affective, physiological, and subconscious reactions to experience, are fuzzy rather than specific. That is to say, in describing our feelings, at least to begin with, we reach for overall categories because our subconscious emotional reactions are themselves imprecise. We distinguish among nuances when we begin to consciously interpret these responses. Real people's self-reports about emotion tend to be as vague as Elizabeth's. This is part of Barrett's argument against basic emotion theory. Barrett challenges the existence of basic emotions after reviewing hundreds of studies on emotion, which led her to conclude that they are not nearly as consistent, uniform, or clear-cut as many scientists believe. Take facial expression, the most frequently cited evidence for the existence of innate, distinct categories of emotion. Barrett found that the evidence is far from clear that facial expressions convey fixed and bound categories of emotion. I must confess that I have a very hard time telling fear from surprise. Let's return to the example of the smile, which can convey a range of meanings. Where basic emotion scientists note the common denominator of these meanings, those who favor a dimensional view highlight the differences. They point out that smiles can express meanings so distinct as to signal entirely different modes of feeling. They wouldn't agree that the smile of happiness for being with a loved one has much in common with the smile that comes from listening to the folly of your neighbors. When the same evidence points to two different conclusions, what you think has a lot to do with where you draw the boundary between modes of feeling. I might think these two experiences have enough in common to signal the same emotion. Broadly speaking, you might disagree. Even at the level of bodily response and neural circuitry, the emotions don't appear to be as basic as is widely believed. The amygdala, the structure in rats that Ledoux studied, is definitely involved in fear responses. But it's involved in generating other emotions, such as surprise, even in rats. And it has other important functions, such as tagging an event as important so that we remember it. The same complexity is true for the adrenaline response on the part of Ledoux's rats. Fear definitely triggers the release of adrenaline, but so do other kinds of stress responses, such as anger, which calls on many of the same neural areas and shares many of the same hormonal responses as fear. Even positive emotions such as excitement involve adrenaline. Although Barrett claims that she isn't a pure social constructionist, someone who believes that all our responses, including emotions, are shaped entirely by culture, Her theory does argue that influence from the environment is paramount in turning subconscious, dimensional emotions into specific feelings. I think she's right insofar as culture instills values and norms that become second nature to us. But nevertheless, I can't help but feel that she's thrown the baby out with the bathwater. Of course, we need to take the environment and culture into account when considering emotion in humans, and likely in many other mammals as well. But this doesn't mean denying the strong influence of evolutionarily older modes of processing that we share with other mammals. My objection to a purely dimensional theory of emotion comes somewhat ironically not from the hard neuroscience of emotion, which often aligns itself with the basic emotion approach, but rather from psychotherapeutic theory, where messiness and indistinctness are often the rule. In Barrett's terms, if a person has a strong negative reaction to someone, specific content will subsequently be attached to that reaction. There's no specific content before we recognize or experience the emotion as a feeling. And if emotions have no distinctive characteristics prior to becoming feelings, if they're broad, affective responses, then whatever way in which we experience or label our emotions must, by definition, be correct. If what you experience as fear is merely negative and strong at the subconscious level, in other words, if it's dimensional, then repressing that fear wouldn't be possible because it wouldn't exist to be repressed in the first place. Yet this is certainly not the case with Elizabeth, or with me, or likely with you either. It's indeed possible to misinterpret your emotions. Elizabeth has a strong negative reaction to Darcy, but she doesn't realize that hurt, humiliation, and fear, the fear of being unattractive and never finding a husband, are as much a part of the mix as dislike and disapproval. If we can misinterpret our emotions, then there must be something there to misinterpret to begin with. Something specific must be happening at the subcortical, subconscious level that differentiates one emotion from another in very specific terms, at least in many cases. And if something specific is happening at the subconscious level of emotional response, that is, if fear and surprise really are different at this level, then a purely dimensional view is incorrect. Even non-basic emotions would develop entrenched circuits that would generate emotions in the subconscious, and they would be open to misinterpretation by our conscious minds. I haven't come across this particular objection, but the evidence about basic emotion is sufficiently contradictory that many mind-brain scientists have attempted to reconcile the conflict between these two theories rather than abandon basic emotion theory altogether. Elaine Fox suggests that we might possess some emotions that are basic, like fear, and others that originate in dimensional terms. This means that they would acquire their specific quality, indeed their identity, only after cognitive input. So the uncomfortable feeling of sensation like embarrassment, a non-basic emotion, might originate as a strong negative sense of arousal that gets defined at the level of consciousness, as Barrett maintains. Yok Pongsep of rat-tickling fame and Douglas Watt argue that affect consists of instinctual primary, basic emotions, secondary, learned, and tertiary, cognitive levels of responding to and processing information. A focus on these different levels of analysis accounts for opposing perspectives. An emotion such as embarrassment would have a biologically determined component, but then be elaborated by higher-level processes. If you concentrated only on that higher-level input, you'd deny the existence of basic emotions. Along similar lines, psychologists Andrea Scarantino and Paul Griffiths argue that basic emotions, as they are usually defined, are far too inclusive because they follow popular definitions of emotion rather than referring to truly biological and universal responses. These latter kinds of response do indeed exist. For instance, The kind of fear experienced by a sudden loss of support exhibits all the qualities assigned to basic emotions: a distinctive physiological response, a predictable developmental appearance, and an evaluation of the situation that focuses on a motivating factor. Snake, young lady. Jesse Prince, a mind-brain philosopher, rejects the distinction between basic and non-basic emotions altogether to claim that the opposition between biology, nature, and cultural construction, nurture, is false. Prince argues that all emotions, including basic ones that we are biologically designed to develop, contain this mixture of cognitive input and physiological response. If you see a long, thin object in your path, or even a predatory young lady, although your fear might share physiological markers with the fear experienced by rats, for you, knowledge and culture shape your experience of fear in very human ways. Prince's view dovetails with the others I've mentioned because it suggests that the multiple areas in the human brain contribute input from different levels of processing in emotional responses. That basic emotions find further processing and elaboration in the human brain makes sense because it follows the general rule of evolution. Creatures adapt and innovate on the structures they inherit, so that these eventually become functionally different from their ancestral forms. Fins became both arms and wings, and while you can see the similarities in all three structures, they are decidedly unlike one another in form and purpose. In this way, humans and some other animals might have developed additional and more nuanced ways of generating and expressing emotions, even basic ones, because these adaptations served us well. In addition, the density of our interconnections among brain areas means that there are few neural circuits that don't receive input from all over the brain. Different areas of the human brain work together and extend our basic responses in ways that aren't seen in rats, although likely shared with mammals closer to us in terms of evolutionary time and development, or who have developed on a parallel track, such as birds. In short, if rats have basic emotion circuits, then humans do as well. And if culture provides input into those emotions in humans, the same is likely true for chimps and bonobos. Many basic emotion theorists would agree, while still maintaining that universal responses and dedicated neural circuitry are involved in some emotions. We can apply these views of emotion processing as multi-tiered to Elizabeth's reactions to Darcy. There are many non-basic aspects of her dislike, which are complicated and depend on cognitive and cultural input. And these feelings continue to develop in complexity and subtlety throughout their relationship, but at the same time, Elizabeth had certainly responded to Darcy's initial insult with at least one basic emotion, fear, that no man would find her handsome enough to marry, and this endured. It was too painful to be admitted to conscious thought, but it exerted a strong influence on all of Elizabeth's responses. If Darcy's remark invoked the basic emotion of fear for Elizabeth, then there is something happening subconsciously that Elizabeth fails to register. She accounts for her negative reaction to Darcy in more palatable ways. Although this fear is itself influenced by cultural input, by the wish and the need for a woman of Elizabeth's class to find a husband, it might have basic core fear circuitry no different from that of a rat. All these theorists and many others acknowledge the complexity of affect in humans. We might possess the circuitry for basic emotion, but in humans, emotions never stay basic for long. And so, the seeming indistinctness of emotional responses and expressions, a rationale for the dimensional approach, might be better explained by the complexity rather than the fuzziness of human responses. Although humans do have basic emotions, we can have mixed responses that make it difficult to exactly pinpoint and separate out specific emotions. Elizabeth might use a general word such as pleased, not because her emotions are vague and dimensional, but rather because there are so many of them involved that it's difficult to parse them. Perceiving Wickham's apparent preference for her, Elizabeth might feel flattered, confident and hopeful about her ability to find a husband, all feelings that validate her sense of self-worth and lead to feeling pleased. When basic emotion theory is qualified, it is less open to charges of imprecision and non-universality leveled by Barrett and other critics. Refining rather than discarding basic emotion makes sense in terms of both evolution and the workings of the mind-brain. The complex, nuanced quality of human affect doesn't make things easy for humans. We have a lot of sophisticated neural wiring built atop and integrated with some very primitive and basic structures. Much of our mind-brain development, at least half, depends on experience rather than genetics. There's ample opportunity for things to go wrong, much more so than in the case of other mammals, although they too are susceptible to mental afflictions such as trauma. And as every pet owner knows, they have distinctive personalities. The higher up the animal on any given branch of the evolutionary ladder, the truer this is. Great apes can certainly be characterized using the 5-factor personality scale. Even my guinea pigs, Kira and Dax, have distinct characters. But for simpler animals, life is simpler. What does it feel like to be a cat? If you have food, water, love, and something to do, such as hunt, even if it's plush animals, my cat Talia does this, play with toys and explore, and you haven't experienced terrible trauma or aren't predisposed to be anxious, it's probably rather satisfying. But if a cat's life is easier than our own in many ways, it lacks certain joys that are distinctly human and which involve distinctly human situations and responses. For my cats, there are no Pemberleys, no Darcys either, and no Jane Austen. Whether we experience basic emotions like fear or more complex emotions like embarrassment, in a normally functioning mind-brain, emotion is involved in every moment of thought, both conscious and subconscious. It took cognitive science the better part of the 20th century to discover this, although psychotherapy, its scorned poor relation, has known it all along. Nor was mainstream philosophy any more astute about the significance of emotion and other forms of affect to human life and thought. Novelists have been immeasurably more intelligent on the topic. And of course, Jane might well be the smartest of them all. 2. Pride and Prejudice and Brains. Through Darcy's Eyes. Let's start with a look, a catching of the eye. Vision is, after all, the sense that most of us rely on for information about the world. So we'll begin with the look exchanged between Darcy and Elizabeth at the Meryton Ball, where they first meet. The ball is a thrilling event for Meryton's excited young ladies and their hopeful mothers, since the community has recently acquired 2 eligible bachelors, Darcy and Bingley. Their presence transforms the ball from a country dance to a matter of life and death, or at least of financial solvency, since in Austen's day, marriage was the only respectable career option for daughters of upper and middle class families. Those who lacked family money and failed to marry faced humiliating and potentially harsh options. They would either have to depend on the charity of friends and family, or take a position as a paid companion or governess. The latter is a prospect dreaded by Jane Fairfax and Emma. To further complicate things for the Bennet family, they have no male heirs, and so the family estate is destined to go to the closest male relative. The Bennets would have no other residence or source of income upon the death of Mr. Bennet, so the family needs to marry off all 5 of its daughters. As we discussed in the previous chapter, Bingley enjoys himself immensely at the ball, in part because he is falling in love with Elizabeth's sister, Jane. But Darcy stiffly endures the event from the sidelines. When Bingley encourages Darcy to dance, he refuses, declaring that there's no one in the room worth dancing with. Bingley gestures towards Jane's sister, Elizabeth, who's sitting close enough to overhear their conversation, but Darcy isn't convinced. He looks in her direction and scornfully replies, "Which who do you mean?" And turning round, he looked for a moment at Elizabeth. Still catching her eye, he withdrew his own and coldly said, "She is tolerable, but not handsome enough to tempt me. And I am in no humor at present to give consequence to young ladies who are slighted by other men. You had better return to your partner and enjoy her smiles, for you are wasting your time with me." Darcy's contemptuous glance begins what might well be the most famous romance in all of English literature. But let's consider it from a more technical point of view, in terms of what actually happens in Darcy's brain when he looks at Elizabeth. This point of view might not come naturally or even be all that enticing to literature buffs. As a society, our education and our interests all too often divide between the arts and the sciences. But I'm convinced that Austen would have appreciated knowing about the brain. Although she wasn't a scientist, she was nevertheless a most astute observer of human nature, along what we recognize as scientific principles. She never wrote about things she couldn't witness, such as men's conversations when alone. Equipped with astute powers of observation, she came to understand people so accurately that we can use her novels to illustrate the science of social intelligence. Austen would have realized that psychological understanding is deepened and expanded by knowing about the brain as well as the mind. Today, most psychologists no longer think in terms of a mind versus a brain, but of a mind-brain. And the different disciplines that focus on one or the other of these entities have come to be so intertwined that their boundaries are no longer distinct. Psychologists understand the basics of neuroscience.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.